Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Nemesis, Book 6, by David Beers, narrated by Travis Baldree. 1. Present Day. Morena floated above death. She had seen death before, numerous times. Death caused by her and death caused by others. Beginnings always had endings, which was something she came to accept long ago, something all Vars must understand. Her own death would mean the passing of power, giving a generation unto the next ruler. Death meant life. Death meant things were born anew. Except for this place. Morena looked down at a very different death, one she didn't accept, one that wouldn't bring life. She saw her children's ashes. Both strands and binums alike, mixed together by wind and weather as if no more than dust. And that's what they are, Morena. It doesn't matter what was or what could have been. They're no longer any of that. They're dead. And look further, Great Var, and you can see this stretching far into the distance. Indeed, you can't even see the end of this abomination. The words mocked her with their truth. Beneath, she saw what the humans left behind, the markings from their machines on the asphalt roads. She saw how close they ventured to her children, how brazen they were about the murder they brought. They had stood mere feet away, as if her children weren't capable of wiping out their entire world, as if they weren't already doing it. They're not. Not anymore. The humans were brazen because they could be. She knew who did this, the one who created this gray ash she floated above. Kenneth Marks. And then he left, hiding after starting a plague on her species. She alone remained here with her dead children, holding the only vigil they would ever know. She turned around, looking back across the land that she had considered conquered. No more. The gray death swept across this area like paint on canvas. Morena didn't know what it was that moved through her children, killing them so efficiently. She didn't even know if she could touch their remains, or if it would infect her as well. Unknowns everywhere she turned, yet everything still relied on her, though she held no answers. Morena slowly descended from the sky, landing on the road just outside of her dead children's reach. He, Kenneth Marks, had stood here, or near it. She felt certain. He stood here and watched the death he created spread through those she cared most about. And did he smile? Morena had seen it, that smile, witnessed it in the cage while in charge of Will. Yes, for sure, the motherfucker smiled as it started. He might still be smiling, wherever he went. Morena dropped to one knee. If the death still lived in the ash, then all of this would be over momentarily. No more worries, no more struggle. Just the end of her and Binimian. She reached forward and picked up the gray that had once been pure white. Her aura wrapped around it, searching as quickly as it could for danger. It found nothing. Just lifelessness. She let the aura continue swirling and watched as it swept out among the remaining dead, searching within them as well. Some clue. Some knowledge as to what happened and how she could stop it. Nothing. Morena closed her eyes and called her aura back. She wrapped her arms around her knee. Rage welled inside, rage that she had never known before, not during her attempted execution, not during any of Childress' sermons. Rage against a universe that wouldn't let her live, wouldn't let her children live. She didn't scream. Made no noise as she knelt alone on the asphalt. She let the rage rise like waves in a typhoon, slamming against whatever was in their way. An hour passed, perhaps more, and then Morena rose to her feet. The universe would bend. The arc of fate would bend, if that's what it took. She wasn't a woman, no more than Morena. Yet the creature was clearly female. Michael saw her, though he didn't understand how that was possible. The landscape around him remained a bare desert, completely devoid of life, and he'd been in it for hours at this point, seeing nothing but the blackness of Brian's mind. There she stood, though. A mile away? Maybe more? Michael couldn't tell distance in here, and if it wasn't for the color wrapping around her, he probably wouldn't have seen her at all. The white aura hung from her like Morena's green. This white, though, resembled the pure white of the ship that dropped from the sky in the field. It looked like the ship Morena traveled in. The white aura blew around the creature, revealing her body of the same nature, the same purity. Am I dreaming? Michael wondered. But could he dream, given the current state of his mind? He stood up from the sand, dusting himself off as he did. The creature raised an arm, though she was too far away for him to understand the gesture. Was she waving? Beckoning? He didn't know what she wanted, but knew he didn't want to go to her. Despite the purity her white brought to mind, whatever she wasn't human. That creature was of Morena's ilk, and she shouldn't be in here. Not in Brian's mind, nor his. Neither had any contact with a creature like this, so why could he see her? Could Brian? No, he wasn't here. The vastness of Brian's mind amazed Michael, but his friend rarely came inside this place. Michael didn't ask why, because he didn't need to. Brian wouldn't find anything in here, just like Michael hadn't until now.
What do you want?
He said silently.
How are you even here?
The creature let her hand drop to her side, but didn't move in any other way. Then, after a few seconds at least, she began crossing the desert sand, heading directly toward him.
If the Makers exist, they created nothing greater than this.
The world before Junior stretched out in an endless array of flames and smoke. He had done very little in this city, Los Angeles. No, his army, his brothers and sisters, they created this destruction. And it was good. He only watched, directed, and assessed. Junior walked across the broken ground, moving lightly from jagged concrete to fractured pole, flying just a few inches above the devastation when necessary. Smoke brushed across his face, the smell of burning gasoline venturing with it. Junior walked upwards, climbing the wrecked buildings, wanting to gain a higher vantage point to see what they had truly accomplished. The rocks and rubble tumbled around him as he climbed, his feet causing slight shifts in the way the new structures lay. He didn't stop, though. Didn't even pause, as the moment something crumbled, he would simply lift into the air or have his aura hold the structure together. And finally, he stood 100 feet above the ground. He turned around, slowly, taking it all in, understanding just how much they had been able to do, how far they had pushed, how many lives they took. He saw Bynum still fighting, scattering the few remaining people that hadn't fled or died. Some looked at him and some at each other. Junior glanced up at the mountain backdrop to the city. When he first arrived here, those mountains had been an aside, something to look at once his eyes moved past the city. Now the mountains were the largest structures around for miles. Now, Junior's eyes went to them first. He brought himself back to the destruction, wanting to understand if he could have done anything differently, perhaps made the attack safer or more efficient. The ground glittered back up at him, glass twinkling in the dying sunlight. The sun would rise again, though. Junior understood that. Tonight, it would fall, and tomorrow the flames would be just a bit less and Bynumian's life just a bit stronger. All over the West Coast, this occurred. Up and down the state humanity had called California. And where Junior started this? Texas existed now only in memory, as anything resembling the land that humans conquered had passed from existence. Perhaps on long stretches of highway, where no one ever lived, people would recognize their world. Even now, Junior felt confident whatever survivors lived in that state were trying to make it to those spared pieces of land. They would find somewhere to hide, which was fine at the moment. Junior's group, and the groups still being born, would find the rogue humans and end them. He said nothing to those below him, and they offered no words either. His brethren hungered for the next city. At this rate, the entire United States would lie under white strands or broken buildings within the week, and from there, Junior would take this army across the world.
Feed them, then, Junior thought. Give them the next city.
And he did. 2. Present day. Will felt the wind beating against his helmet. He kept one hand above his head as if somehow that could protect him if something happened with the helicopter. Any slip from the chopper and Will would open his eyes next in the afterlife, or, if nothing awaited, never open them again. He watched the chopper slowly descend. The pilot obviously had his orders, understood that he couldn't simply put the machine down on the ground. Doing that meant the chopper would never take off again.
Christ, Will said, as the helicopter floated a foot or so off the ground.
He couldn't remember the last time he had to make a jump like this. The hard part was climbing aboard without tipping the thing too much in either direction. Nothing on the chopper could touch the ground. Nothing. He looked at the front of the helicopter and saw the pilot looking back at him. He gave Will a thumbs up, clearly meaning that now was as good a time as any to climb aboard.
We put less thought into this whole operation than what moves through a dog's head over the course of its life.
Will stood in his suit, much too heavy to jump with, unable to take it off, and a helicopter that couldn't tilt more than 12 inches in any direction without ending the whole damn thing. And if he somehow managed to leap into a floating machine without killing everyone involved, well, then they would fly that same machine down to the alien's base, and Will would attempt some more acrobatics.
Christ, he said again.
He brought his hand down from above his head, his right at his side automatically flexing into a fist, prepping for what came next. He didn't know if the ice shooting from the bottom of his suit would move quick enough to protect him from the reaching strands, because they would be reaching, without doubt. No time to think about it, though. Only time to jump. Will's legs flexed, his muscles firing at his command, doing their best to carry him to safety. All of it happened in a split second. His body launched forward, one foot in front of the other, as he pushed to gain enough speed to lift him and his spaceman suit off the ground. He didn't look down, didn't check to see if the strands were pushing past the slower-moving cold his suit produced, but kept his eyes focused on the chopper's door. And then he lifted, ascending into the air, trying to clear the helicopter's skid, then trying to clear the door itself. He closed his eyes for a brief second as he made contact, opening them again immediately as he desperately tried to grab hold of something, because he had cleared the door, but if he didn't catch onto some piece of the helicopter, he would slide clear out the other side, landing sprawled on his back in the middle of the white cake. Will's hand shot out and grabbed the lower half of the co-pilot's seat, his gloved fingers trying to turn into a fist. His shoulder pulled, a sharp pain moving up through the right side of his chest, and then he lay still. Breath poured in and out of his mouth, fogging up his helmet. He felt the helicopter's motion and tried to understand if it tilted one way or the other. Nothing. The chopper floated level in the air. Will sat up, slowly, letting the fog dissipate in his helmet, looking down at his body to understand what, if any, damage occurred. His eyes flashed up and down his suit, looking for signs of growth, evidence that the strands had reached out and touched him. He saw nothing, though.
You okay? The pilot said.
Will turned around and looked at him, the pain in his shoulder still crying out. He had done something to it, though he didn't have time to diagnose anything. Will gave the pilot a thumbs up with his other hand.
Right as rain,
he said as he reached up and released his helmet.
Where are we headed?
South, Will said. Into the belly.
It's working, Trone said.
Yes. Proud?
Kenneth Marks sat across from the president, all of them back in the safety of the underground bunker's embrace. The rest of the crew was dispersed through the hallways, leaving Trone and Kenneth Marks to look at each other, alone. Kenneth Marks understood what the gesture in itself said, that Trone didn't fear him. There might be Secret Service outside this room, but none inside. No one and nothing to stop Kenneth Marks from snapping Trone's neck as he did the last president. All of it, the entire gesture, was for naught, though. Kenneth Marks could no more kill this man than he could ascend to the presidency himself. Well, that might be pushing it a bit, but to kill Trone would be to kill himself. Kenneth Marks might be able to murder one president and be excused, but two? That would be a stretch for anyone.
I wouldn't use the word proud, he said,
the silence between the two of them having hung long enough.
Then what would you use?
Right, Kenneth Marks said.
Trone smiled and stood up from his side of the desk. He walked across the room, moving behind Kenneth Marks. He listened as the president opened a cabinet, but didn't turn around. The president poured a drink and then closed the cabinet before venturing back into Kenneth Marks' view.
"I'll drink to it," Trone said, still smiling.
He moved to the front of the desk, leaning against the edge.
"So, what's next?"
"Didn't feel the need to offer me one." Trone tilted his head toward the cabinet.
"Go ahead, if you want."
"I'll pass." Kenneth Marks crossed his right leg over his left and then draped his hands over his knee. "I think in about 4 days' time, this will all be over."
4 days, huh? Over for who? You've seen the reports about the West Coast, right?
It would appear they're running amok out there, no?
Yes, Marks, it would appear so. Will there be anything left in 4 days that we even want?
Kenneth Marks finally smiled. Perhaps the drink was a bit early.
4 days is how long it's going to take your magic to reach Grayson?
Give or take a day, yes.
And what do we do with the West until then?
Kenneth Marks stood up and walked to the cabinet behind him. The alcohol was still out, though the doors closed. No ice, just a bottle of scotch. He tilted it up. Macallan, 30-year. He took the top off and breathed in the liquor. He closed his eyes as the smell connected to his brain. When he opened them, he took the second glass on the cabinet and poured a small shot. His back still to the president, he said, "I'm not sure that's under my control, sir."
"Wasn't it your job to stop the invasion?"
"It was my job to stop the cake spread," Kenneth Marks said, turning around with a shot in his hand. "It's your job to stop the invasion." Kenneth Marks took the drink without looking away from the president. Lowering it to his side, he said, "In 4 days, it's not going to matter what they're doing on the West Coast, East Coast, or China. And from the way I see it, there isn't much that can be done. So, will a lot of the world be wrecked? Yeah, there's no doubt about that. But you're going to win." The president said nothing for a few seconds before looking down to his glass, swirling the dark liquor around.
"You don't really expect me to believe that's it, do you, Marks? That you killed my predecessor and then decided to give the world an undeserving gift? You can't expect me to think whatever you've done isn't playing into some plan of yours."
"What plan would that be, sir?"
"You sent that soldier in there, Will, didn't you?"
"I did," Kenneth Marks said.
"And what was that about?"
"Gaining information." The president smiled.
"What information did you gain, Marks?"
"Well, we're going to win, aren't we?" he said. Trone laughed and looked back down to his drink.
"I'm not going to pretend like I can read you, Marks, or really have any idea what's going on in your head. To be honest, I don't have any desire to. I'll tell you, though, the moment I think you're veering from what I want, I'll have you killed."
Everything was going swimmingly. Even the walls seemed to sing that tune, the one saying over and over that all would be okay. Knox wasn't in the room with Trone or Marks, nor did he want to be at this moment. The rest of the leaders, all the delegates from around the world, appeared like they could break into song and dance, so happy with the earlier results. The war was over, even though California was about to fall off the map. Even though the man who set everything into motion this morning had long ago passed from the realm of sanity. None of those things mattered because they all watched Marks kick some dust into the air. Knox opened the door to his room and stood in the doorway for a few seconds. He looked at the made bed, the small faucet with a small mirror hanging over it. He lived like a rat, and had for how many years? Scurrying to and fro, always in the name of America, always for her benefit. And now, in his 50s, he looked at his cage and felt all the miles his tiny rat legs had scurried. As if those miles appeared from nowhere, finally laying out in front of him, all of them somehow mashed into this room. He closed the door behind him, stepping a bit further in. His room, though he had only stayed here a week and would never see it again after next week. So many of his rooms were like that, transient places to rest his rat legs. "Shut up," he said. His voice died a small death against the walls surrounding him. Self-pitying nonsense, because the psycho outside has everyone walking on clouds. That's what these thoughts were about. Rat legs didn't hold the fucking world up, and that's what Knox was doing right now, even if no one else knew it. Trone may or may not be on board the crazy train Marks revved up, and if he was, then Knox stood alone in this. He moved across the room to his bed, sitting down and pulling out the cell phone underneath his pillow. He knew any call would be monitored, but he had nothing to hide. The president knew about Will, and regardless of how much leeway he gave Marks, Knox didn't think the president would kill the line they had with Will. Knox understood what Marks wanted to do, even if he didn't understand how. Will arriving in Grayson was their best chance of stopping him. He hit the redial button and put the phone to his ear, listening to it ring once before Will's voice came over the line.
"Yeah." "Where are you?"
Knox said.
100 miles out," Will said. "Are you seeing anything different than what the satellites have shown?" "No, just white fields. Endless white fields." "Won't be for long," Knox said. "It looks like whatever Marks created is working. The cake is dying up here, moving down toward you."
A pause came over the line.
"What's it mean?" "I don't know. It means that we're beating back those white fields." "There's more. He's not done with her. This is the knife he's twisting in her side, trying to force her to do as he wants."
100 miles?
Knox said.
"A little less now. Get there, and let me know what you find."
3. Present day.
"Do you see her?"
Michael said.
"See who?"
Brian asked. Michael needed no other answer. Only Michael saw the white creature, the one who looked so much like Morena.
"Do you see anything having to do with me?"
Michael said, wondering if Brian saw him sitting in this desert.
"No, I can just feel you."
Michael was balancing the world inside Brian's head with the reality outside. They still sat in the back bedroom, with Ren staring out the window, silent. Silence reigned inside as well, without Michael or Brian having much to say. Until now. Because Michael had to tell them about her.
"What did you mean, do I see her?"
Brian asked, Michael watching as his mind came back from the darkness.
"The three of us need to talk,"
Michael said.
"I see something different than before, and I'm not sure what it means." "Ren?"
Brian said. He watched Ren turn to him, away from the window.
"Michael says he needs to talk."
Ren's eyebrows raised, and he turned the rest of his body, becoming actively engaged. Brian knew what the man thought of him. Ren saw him as a lost cause, someone hosting his son right now. He gave no indication of wanting Brian's help or to even keep him up to date. All of that was fine with Brian. He had no desire to support Ren. In fact, with Michael now in his head, he wondered if he had made a mistake. Because Brian was dying when this was over, he would entertain no other options. And from what he could tell, Michael had nowhere to go. He couldn't get back to his body, now owned by an alien in another part of the house. What did that mean for him when Brian passed from this earth? Nothing good. That's what Brian was beginning to think.
"I'm seeing something,"
Michael said from inside his head. Brian's eyes focused back on Ren, still staring expectantly. He didn't know how much Michael knew or how much he could see from his vantage point. But Brian wouldn't try to hide what he saw as the end. Michael needed to face it just like Brian, just like Thera.
"He says he's seeing something,"
Brian said, becoming the middleman for Michael's words.
"What?"
Brian listened, taking in what Michael gave him, putting it into his own language, understanding it, before speaking.
"It's something like her, like Morena, except white, a white aura like Morena's green one."
"Where is she?" Ren said. "He's still inside you, right?"
"He says she's in there with him. He's sitting in a desert."
Brian felt a smile tug at his lips, knowing what Michael didn't say. The desert was what his personality had left.
"And he sees her standing across it."
"What's she doing?"
"She looks like she might be walking to him, but he can't tell. She's far away and it's dark."
Brian paused, unsure if he should say the next word, unsure why Michael said it, like he couldn't help it.
"He says she's beautiful,"
Brian whispered. He tried to see her, even as he said the words, wanting to peer into whatever world Michael inhabited. He couldn't, though. All he saw inside himself was blackness. No light, no creature.
"You're not giving me much here, Brian," Ren said. "What's it mean? What's he say she wants?"
Brian shook his head, coming back to reality.
He doesn't know. He just wants us to know what he's seeing.
Ren stood up and walked over to Brian. Both looked at each other, Brian knowing what Ren wanted but understanding he wouldn't get it. Brian would never be Michael, no matter how hard or how many times Ren looked into his eyes. And Brian didn't want to look at Ren anymore. He didn't want to look at anything. Because he saw only darkness when he looked inside himself, and the light out here, the light shining off Ren's eyes, only put a spotlight on the area that Brian couldn't enter anymore. Even coming out of the darkness, coming out to talk to Michael, to relay this information, all of it created more pain. Because Brian was changed, more than anyone else involved, and he wasn't changing back. Unending black waited for him in this life, and it waited for him in the next, too. He moved to the side and then around Ren, heading to the bed. He lay down and closed his eyes. Michael fell silent, and the blackness took over. Disbelief wasn't a word that Ren would ever use again. He could see nothing on this earth, or in this universe, too strange for him to believe. But that inability to disbelieve didn't mean he understood everything, because Brian was a complete mystery to him. Ren watched as the boy walked around him, making his way to the fucking bed again. Ren found himself growing angry at it, as if a piece of furniture actually caused his frustration at Brian. The anger only grew, though, because every time Brian did this, he went to the bed. Had he gone to the window and stared outside, Ren would have begun hating the glass. His anger truly grew from the desperation he felt at Brian. The kid was broken and not willing to fight to fix himself. Ren certainly wasn't any professional in that regard, but he was doing his damnedest right now. Ren was keeping it together, for Michael, if no one else, and this kid was acting like a preteen going through his first fucking breakup. Ren didn't know what happened just now, why Brian went from speaking to silence in only a few seconds, but in doing so he shut Michael up as well. So much rested inside the boy now sleeping, or feigning sleep. He connected Ren to his son, and his son to the rest of the world. Brian had Morena's knowledge, or what he was allowed to gather while he'd been possessed, but Michael was different from that. Had been different for quite some time. Michael was connected. Ren didn't know to what, nor did he know how, but he was different than the rest of them. And Brian halted that connection when he shut himself down. That connection might allow Michael to do something. Ren still looked at Brian. The boy's eyes were closed. Ren didn't know if he slept or not, though he wasn't sure much difference existed between wakefulness and sleep for Brian anymore. Something had to be done about him. The conclusion appeared on the horizon of Ren's mind like a blood sunrise, casting light across the world, but red and frightening. Something? But what? Michael lived inside the boy, and what was Ren thinking?
Are you going to harm him? Linda said. Is that what you're seriously considering?
He didn't know, not completely. He didn't want to hurt Brian, but this couldn't continue. He needed to jumpstart whatever Michael was able to do, because in the end, only Michael mattered. Not Brian, not Ren, not the rest of the world. Only Michael's survival.
Jesus, Ren,
his dead wife said.
Shut the fuck up, he whispered.
She wasn't here having to make these decisions. She didn't have to watch all of this, unable to do anything. So she didn't get to judge. Not now, not while he stood here sober, at last, trying to save their son. Even what she said didn't matter. Not anymore. Because she wasn't Michael.
4. Present day.
Thanks, Will yelled at the front of the helicopter. He stood at the door, ready to make the jump. Thumbs up from the pilot. No other communication. That had been his relationship with the man in the cockpit. Hand signals. And when Will jumped from the chopper, their relationship ended. Another person Will would never see again. How many pilots had there been like this?
What the hell are you thinking about?
He didn't know, or rather, didn't know why. He stared out of the helicopter at the white ground 5 feet below him.
This is what it's like when you see death.
He wasn't staring at Morena in all her terrifying glory. He looked at white strands growing over each other where once existed a town called Grayson. He looked into nothingness, and his subconscious couldn't stop understanding that this was it. That when he hopped out of this helicopter, no cavalry would show up to save him. Jumping from this machine was no different than a kamikaze pilot flying into a ship. He had stood here long enough, so long that the pilot had to be wondering if something was wrong. Will jumped, his suit fully attached, and landed on the relatively soft sponge beneath. His boots began shooting their endless cold, attacking the space around him. Will turned and watched as the helicopter pulled up, flying off into the air, leaving him alone in this strange landscape. He looked back at Grayson, Georgia. Weeks ago, this place had been suburbia, if a bit country. Now nothing remained. He couldn't spot a single difference from the area where he now stood and the area in which he had entered the Strand's domain, hundreds of miles away.
Knox, he said, speaking into his helmet, hoping that the general might be holding a mic on the other end.
He waited a few seconds and then said the name again.
Knox!
Nothing came back. Will was completely alone, with no plans or strategies. He turned around, a full circle, looking at the hills and houses, one and the same now, all covered.
Where to? Does it matter?
No, probably not. Just get moving, get some action going, and see what you can find. Wrigley's phone finally lost its connectivity. It had taken a while, but the telephone company finally lost the struggle for the United States' best coverage, apparently. Wrigley snickered at the thought, a twisted and off-kilter smile jumping onto her face like an insect suddenly landing on a picnic.
No more news, she said.
No one else sat in the room with her, but it wasn't completely clear whether she knew that or not. People had started ceasing to exist for Wrigley, falling away like leaves in autumn, scattered by the wind of her thoughts, lost and forgotten. She was bored now, though, because her phone no longer delivered the outside world. She looked up from it for the first time in a few hours, seeing the room around her as if she had never sat in it before. Her mind took a few seconds to catch up, to understand where she was and what she had been doing. Morena. Morena's children. Saving them. Wrigley had her work cut out for her, that was for sure. Though she thought she had done a fairly spectacular job so far. She didn't know what the end result had been with the boy's message. The word... what was that word? She couldn't remember it. She repeated over and over. Hopefully it worked. Certainly it appeared so. The grotesquely growing teenager, who was actually Kenneth Marks, why kid ourselves, had been asleep for some time now. Which was good. As long as Kenneth Marks wasn't up and moving around, the world could keep spinning. And yet, even with all this good news around her, besides her phone disconnecting, because that was just awful, Morena wasn't here. Wrigley didn't remember where the others went, those few people that Marks brought to the house, but they didn't matter any longer. She needed to know where Morena was. She needed Wrigley's help, now more than ever. Wrigley's eyes flashed to her phone again, dashing the thoughts of Morena, mindlessly flipping to her contact list. No thoughts ran through her mind, as if the train she had been on simply disappeared, not even stopping. Wires inside her head misfired at rates too frequent for her to understand they even happened, leaving her unable to focus for long periods of time. Her fingers scrolled down the contact list, watching names come and go, seeing none of them. Just endless words. When she reached the bottom, she started back up. Back and forth, up and down. Wrigley watched the names without a thought in her head. Until she saw Will. Her finger smacked down on the screen, halting the scroll.
Will.
He was a person. He was someone she liked. Had she liked Will in that past life? Certainly parts of him, and yet something dark resided in her mind about him, something that she didn't want to look at. Will. Where was he? She tapped his name on the screen and put it to her ear. 30 seconds passed before she remembered that the phone was out of commission. She put it back down in her lap and stared at the screen instead.
Will, Will, Will. Where are you, William?
The thought went through her head in the tune of a child's song, light and free. And then she remembered that the house had a telephone, underground lines. Would those still work? She stood from her chair and walked into the kitchen, picking up the cordless phone and referring back to her cell. She dialed the number and put it to her ear.
Will?
He couldn't believe the voice in his ears. Not Knox, who had been the only person to contact him. Wrigley spoke to him now, a ghost for all he knew. He walked out of her life when he went to Grayson last, and from what he gathered, she walked out of everyone else's. Yet her voice echoed in his helmet.
Will, are you there?
Wrigley? He said.
Yes. Yes, it's me. What are you doing?
She asked the question like she wanted him to come pick her up and drive her to run an errand, not like she abandoned her species by siding with an invading alien.
Where are you?
The words moved slowly from his mouth as he tried to remain calm. Wrigley's tone said that she walked a very, very thin tightrope, and that the slightest gust of turmoil would send her falling a long way.
I'm with her, Will,
she said.
Where?
In Grayson.
Will didn't say anything for a second, gaining control of his frustration. Of course she was in Grayson. It wouldn't do any good to tell her that, though, not unless he wanted to watch her fall.
Where in Grayson?
We're at a house.
He closed his eyes, blocking out the white surrounding him. He needed her to give him something that made sense, but she wasn't able to make that connection. She certainly didn't know where she was, no coordinates, and most likely she had lost the ability to even access that information. The Wrigley of old was dead. He didn't know this person, despite how her voice sounded. Will couldn't save her. All he could do was get to her and hope that he might be able to do something to the alien who once ruled his own mind.
How did you get my number, Wrigley?
I looked it up in my cell phone.
Will shook his head, unable to smile at the absurdity of it all.
You still have your cell phone?
Uh-huh.
Okay, I want you to pull up the maps on it. You're still going to get satellite reception. Tell me where you are.
Why?
She said. Was he the enemy? Is that what she saw him as now? If so, she wouldn't let him anywhere near that house. Again, though, he found himself out of choices. The only one left to him, which didn't make it much of a choice, was hope. Hope that Wrigley, even if she didn't like him, perhaps some part of her might trust him.
Oh, yeah? After Bolivia?
He pushed the thought away.
I'm here to help, Wrigley.
Help who?
And only one word came to his mind.
You.
He listened to silence, not hearing any clicks of her phone turning off. He hoped she was doing as he asked, finding her goddamn location.
You ready?
She said, as if he was going to write this down, like she was giving him directions to a barbecue.
Yeah.
33.89 north and 83.96 west.
Will repeated the numbers in his head, not knowing if Wrigley kept speaking. He had to remember them, and at 50 plus, his memory wasn't what it used to be. Finally, when he thought he had it all in his head, he turned his attention back to her.
Really? What's happening there?
Well, she's gone right now.
Morena?
Yeah,
Wrigley said.
Where did she go?
Wrigley went quiet for a second, and Will waited for the click to tell him she hung up.
She didn't say.
Her voice quiet, pained. Because she cared about the alien. Morena just leaving? It hurt, Wrigley.
Stop the psychoanalyzing. Find out what you can and then get your ass there. What's happening at the house?
I think Kenneth Marks is here,
she said, the pain in her voice replaced with a conspiratorial whisper. Will didn't even know where to go with that statement. Not what it meant, not anything.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.